How many of you washed your hands before you came into worship today? How many of you touched the handle out there and then washed your hands? Uh-oh. What? I can't do anything because it's turned on my side. So. But I heard popping again. Oh, Lord. Some of you understand that the reason that the screen wasn't working was because it froze, right? That's just one of the fun privileges we get to have in worship is things try to interrupt what we're going to do. And can I just warn you that there are sometimes things that want to keep you from worshiping God? So here's what I thought would really be fun is everybody who had a fight this morning to get here, stand up. No, you don't need to. Usually sometimes the greatest conflict in families occurs when? Right after worship, right? No. It's the conflict that occurs at Bedside Baptist. Yeah. It's the conflict that occurs after breakfast when it's time to get in the car. It's the pastor this week who said he had to apologize to his son. Because his son was supposed to be at rehearsal for the worship team early, and so dad went down. He's all happy and praising the Lord. I get to go down to worship today. And all. He gets into the car, and he's sitting there, and he's singing away. And then he looks at his watch, and his son's not there. And pretty soon his singing turns into, "It's taking longer. Okay, he's not here yet. I'd blow the horn, except the neighbors will know. Okay, come on, man, get down here." And finally the kid gets in the car, only he comes with a big glass of milk. With two pieces of bread covered with jelly, and the jelly's running over the milk. And he gets in the car, "Hi, Dad!" And Dad's like, speaking in tongues, you know how that works. So he jumps in the car, and as he starts to back out, of course the milk's spilling, the jelly's dripping on the floor, and pretty soon, on the way to worship and worship rehearsal, Dad gets one of those privileged opportunities to discipline his child verbally. Yeah. Lays into him about his behavior and all. And as he gets to the worship, he drives into the parking lot. It's like, "I think I kind of blew it, didn't I?" And he hits him. And he has to stop. And now he gets the moment for the real lesson. And he turns to his son. He says, "Son, you know, some of the stuff I said may have been true, but the way I said it was all wrong. And I need to apologize and ask your forgiveness for the way I just treated you." And with the jelly still dripping and the milk spilling, his son looks up, "Thanks, Dad. Love you." And bounds on into the worship rehearsal. Did you wash your hands? It's interesting. If you're a real hygienist, you'll do like the lady we met at the at the post office the other day. She was talking about, I reached out my hand to shake hands with her. Virgil had introduced me. By the way, Virgil knows everybody. I reached out my hand to shake hands with this lady, and she said, "Oh no, I don't shake hands." And so she kind of shoulders me and like that. And okay, well, that's cool. And she says, "You know, I've just kind of become very hygienic conscious and all." And I said, "Oh, okay." So then a bright idea. You know, "Well, how do you get in the door right there?" And she shows how she gets in without touching it by using her whatever clothing, apparel, something like that she has to get in the door and all. And it was interesting thinking about that. You know, you realize, I know some of you might be compulsive. What's it called? Obsessive compulsive. Yeah, with, you know, hygiene. And here's the, don't listen for the next minute if you're obsessive compulsive with hygiene, okay? Plug your ears. You can't avoid germs. Okay, it doesn't matter where you touch and everything like that. Well, this morning we're going to ask, did you clean your hands? Okay, but you probably get it already, don't you? It's a deeper question than that. And Jesus' disciples are going to be asked, why don't your disciples, in fact, clean their hands? So we're going to look at Mark, the 7th chapter, and go through the first 13 verses of Mark, chapter 7. And we are continuing in our series of trying to learn what Jesus was teaching the disciples about following him. We call it discipleship. Discipleship is us trying to become more and more like Jesus Christ. And Jesus is doing his most important ministry. He's doing all kinds of stuff with the crowds, right? I mean, he fed 5,000 of them just a couple weeks ago. He's healing them all left and right. He's doing all kinds of stuff with people. However, his most important ministry is the work he's doing with 12 men as he's preparing them for when he dies, rises from the dead, and then ascends up into heaven and says, okay, guys, now the world is in your hands. Go make disciples of all nations. Teach them to obey everything I've commanded you. Baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age. It's a mission that he's given to whom? Fortunately, it was just given to those 12, and the rest of us can just sit here and watch, right? The mission has been given to all of us for us to become like Jesus Christ and to take the message of Christ's love back out into the world. So Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 13. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were unclean. That is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the tradition of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, kettles, pans, and the list goes on and on. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with unclean hands? And he replied. Now I'm about to read the heart of the message this morning. And you can miss everything I say, but don't miss what Jesus says in this next couple of verses. And don't let this text be just focused on the Pharisees. The Pharisees were not as bad as we think. The Pharisees are guys, people who want to honor God. They actually had a sincere desire. In fact, the Pharisees probably developed some of their history and the elders and their teachings developed out of clear back at the time of Daniel, the time of the children of Israel coming back from captivity. It's Ezra and Nehemiah, and they're reading the word of God, and the people are repenting, and they're broken, and they're like, you know, whoa, God's real. And they have literally a revival in Israel, and it's all because they're reading God's word. And what is it that they're reading? Watch out. They're reading Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. They're reading the Torah. That's the word of God that they had. And what they really get focused on is the message of what God had done with Israel when he brings them out of bondage. And he gives them the Ten Commandments, instructions for living, statements about how you can have an incredible life if you will follow after God. Jesus took those 10 and summarized them, and one of the Pharisees actually said, you got it, man. Well, that's not quite how he said it, but he was speaking Aramaic, so it doesn't matter, you won't understand. Nevertheless, he said, Jesus, you're right on. This is the right message. Because Jesus summarized the Ten Commandments with this. He says, you shall love the Lord your God with your whole heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second commandment is this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And he says, and the whole law, all of the commandments, all of the instructions, and all 10 of those key statements for successful living are found in those two statements. Love God with your whole heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. Those are the commandments. Love God. Love neighbor. Everything is summarized by those two things. And the Pharisee says, yeah, that is so true. Wow, yes. And see, the Pharisees were not bad people. They were trying to do what they could to live that law out in their lives. And one of those statements that talked about loving the Lord like God was to remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. And people started asking, well, how do I know when I'm doing that? There were some very, very, very basic instructions in the Old Testament, in the Torah. That's the first five books, the Pentateuchs. There were some very simple instructions about what you did or didn't do. Very simple. And people said, like, you know, well, I don't want to mess up here. So give us some more kind of counsel on this, some more instruction. Eventually, the scribes started coming up with statements and instructions. And it was an oral tradition that they developed, an oral law. And they started following this. And it kind of like saying, you know, if you're going to get ready for worship here on Sunday, wouldn't it be good if you prepared yourself on Saturday night? Wouldn't it be good? Wouldn't it be good if when you came in that door, you had stopped before you ever even entered that door and said, God, I want you to speak to me even at the places where I don't want to listen. Holy Spirit, I want you to fill up this place, and I want you to be able to work freely in people's lives, and I want you to begin by working in me. God, show me the stuff that bothers you about my life and the very things I may have done this week that are in the way. Show me those things. Wouldn't it be good if we did things like that? Now, that would be good until the point that we'd start saying, so, Russ, did you do it? You didn't stop and pray before you came in today, huh? Well, Leslie did, and you didn't, and, you know. You know, you're messed up, man. You're messed up, and you better get it right now. So next week, you need to kneel down out there. You need to put your head on the ground, man, and bang it a little bit. And the following week, we come back and we say, Carol, did you do it? You didn't either? Well, man, you better get out there, bang your head on the ground, and start wailing or something like that. And we come up this list of things and all, and pretty soon we're so focused on all of that that you say, you know, why are all those Baptists over there banging their heads on the ground outside the church and all? They're weird. Well, they are weird. And you know what? We're going to do something strange. How many of you have a cell phone with you? It doesn't have to be a smartphone, but it does have to text. Okay. If you can, how many can text? All right. For those of you who don't have a cell phone, can't text, take out the white piece of paper that's in your bulletin. For those of you who can text, the number you're going to text is 909. No, no, wait. What's Paul's number? I want you to text to Paul instead of me. No. The number you're going to text is 909-835-2446. Some of you are saying, oh, that's Pastor Bill's. Yep. So if you have Pastor Bill, you're going to text Pastor Bill. All right? And here's what you're going to text. I believe, did I put it on the slide, Mike? Because I can't see the slide. The next slide. What does this church do that might be worshiping in vain? Let me help you out yet. I paused in the middle of the text. I said that the most important verse is these next two verses. I said that we need to pray that we will listen to what Jesus says in these two verses. So listen to what he says. He replied to the question, don't your disciples wash their hands, you know, before eating? Like, you know, it's kind of bad, you know. Don't they follow the traditions of the elders? They're messed up, Jesus. He replied, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to the traditions of men. And he said to them, you have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. For Moses said, honor. See, it's not on silent, but somebody's already texting me. I need to put it on silent so you all don't hear all that. There you go. Okay. So You have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. For Moses said, honor your father and your mother, and anyone who curses his father or mother must be put to death. Whoa, we'd have a lot of kids who would never make it past junior high. I mean, I'm just telling you. Or would it be high school when it'd really get bad? Blank you, Dad! Yeah, right, okay, yeah, you're dead. And it wasn't the dad that got to do the killing, incidentally, by the way. Okay, so going on. But you say that if a man says to his father or mother, whatever help you might otherwise have received from me, it is Corban. That is a gift devoted to God. Then you no longer let them do anything for his father or mother. Thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and you do many things like that. It's interesting. A word, Corban, became a curse word. Corban. It was something dedicated to God. And if you determined that something was Corban, you said, this is for God. It's meant to be for his purposes. And I want to dedicate it to him. We do that with children when they're first born, right? We say, okay, God, this child belongs to you. I want to dedicate them to you. Parents, dedicate children to God and say, okay, now God, I want to try to help raise this child to come to know you someday. So I'm making a commitment to you on their behalf, God, that I will dedicate them and I'll do what I can so they can grow up and someday come to know Jesus Christ personally by their own choice. Dedicate. Well, here's what started happening. If son or daughter didn't want to give their money to mom and dad when they got older, because mom and dad would come and the whole retirement system was not Social Security or some other kind of 401k plan or anything else like that, guess who what your retirement plan was? Your children. You took care of them, and then when you got old, they took care of you. But they learned this little loophole. You know, I got all this money, and I really don't want to have to give it to mom and dad. Got an idea. I'll call it Corban. This is Corban. It belongs to God. It doesn't belong to me anymore. It belongs to God. Now, by the way, I will continue to use it, and if there's anything left after I'm done using it, that's going to go to God. But in the meantime, I'm sorry, mom, dad, can't give you anything because it's Corban. Now, it's interesting, the rules on Corban allowed you to do all kinds of things with it, and you could actually, at some point in time, say, okay, it's no longer Corban. Mom and Dad are dead. It's now mine again. And he's saying, look, Corban has become a cuss word, frankly. It's become a negative term. You know, I'm Corbaning you. I'm going to take anything that I have that's mine, and I'm going to keep it from you, and I'm not going to share. I'm Corbaning you. And listen to this. Doesn't this almost sound like blasphemy? This belongs to God. Kept it from you. And people would do things like that. Have you ever heard a teenager be really upset at mom or dad and say something like this? I hate you. I'm leaving and never coming back. At least not until dinner. haven't kids even done that? And it doesn't have to be because parents are really bad. It can be because parents are really good. That kids do statements like that. Well, look at scripture there. Corban said, hey, once you made that, whoa. Everything I have belongs to God and you don't get any of it, mom or dad. It couldn't go to them. Total misuse of the understanding of dedicating something to God for his purposes, isn't it? Well, with that in mind, what does this church do that might be worshiping in vain? Please text me, or if you want to write me on that white piece of paper that's in your bulletin, you can write it quick, and Russell run around the room and get them. Go. They're not ready, sorry. So, somebody texted me already. Hey, I got six of you. Whoops. Six of you that have texted already. Let's see what somebody has said. Okay. Somebody texted the question back to me. Whoop. Okay. Greeting only our friends at church. We need to branch out in fellowship. No one shall move about while we are praying. The question came again. Pastor Bill. The question again. So, you're not supposed to text me the question. You're supposed to text me your answer. The question again. I guess you're all saying that the question is something we do that's done in vain. Speed prayer, attitude before prayer, having mind not on God. Our youth really have fun with this on Thursday nights. Start to pray or start to do a song or something like that, and they're all chattering away. Like, guys, if you're talking, don't you want other people to listen? So if we're talking to God, wouldn't it be good for you all to be quiet? Okay, here's one. Not curbing their tongue when in the building. So you got curb it out there, like I was saying. I was going to pound those heads. You're going to have to. Okay. Coming in late regularly and disturbing others. Perhaps we care more about Americans in need than people in other parts of the world. Okay, did anyone write anything down? Russ, did anyone write anything down on your white piece of paper? Okay, Tanya's got her hand up. Virgil's got his hand up. I thought you knew how to text. No, get them all together so I don't know who they're from. Who else? Anyone else? Ruth's got one over here, Russ. There you go. Ruth's got one right there. There was paper in the bulletin. Anyone else? Is anyone else texting me? So what are the rest of you doing? Are you here this morning? I said, are you here this morning?
Yes.
Oh, okay, good, good. Okay. Not using the church to full potential, we should have a garden and movie night outside. Doing so without humility, without soul searching. I think I got another one. Whoops. Not listening to the truth in your heart before worship. Communion only on first Sunday, worship only on Sunday. The set format of the service, people getting upset when changed up. So, how many of you washed your hands? No, what I mean is, how many of you ceremonially washed your hands today? Watch this video.
In ancient times, the priests used to sanctify themselves before eating holy food. And that is what Netilat Yadayim is for us. It's a way of saying the meal we are about to eat is holy, and we are preparing ourselves for that holiness.
A special cup with two handles, called a kvot, is used to wash the hands. Before we eat a meal of bread, we wash our hands in a special way. This is called Netilat Yadayim. The kvot containing the water is passed to the left hand, and then water is poured three times on the right hand. Then the cup is passed to the right hand, and water poured three times onto the left hand. The water should cover the entire hand up to the wrist. It is customary to hold the cup with a towel when pouring on the left hand. A little water should remain on the left hand to be rubbed over both hands while reciting the blessing.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech ha'olam, asher kiddushanu b'mitzvosav v'tzivanu al netilas yodoyim.
Then the hands are dried. One should not talk until the blessing Hamotzi has been recited over the bread.
We should offer a time to pray and heal with others regularly. Now, how many of you washed your hands today, ceremonially? None of us. And did you catch the video kind of started a little quiet? And what you need to know is that the ceremonial washing of hands was done before the eating of the matzah bread. When did you eat the matzah bread? At Passover. It was unleavened bread. And so this was about what would take place before going to and participating in Passover. And even prior to that, what the significant moment was, this was done specifically by the priests. The priests, before they would go into the Holy of Holies, they'd wash their hands before they would eat the bread that was placed there, which that was their responsibility to eat. They would do the ceremonial cleansing. And then by the time it got to Jesus' day, what happened? Any time you ate bread, you were supposed to do ceremonial cleansing. During the meal, as you changed food, you were supposed to do ceremonial cleansing of your hands. If you went to the marketplace, well, you know who's in the marketplace, right? People. All kinds of people. Some of them are good Jews, some of them are bad Jews. Some of them are worse than that, non-Jews. And so you have to, if you're going to come in contact with that, you may have come in contact with somebody who touched something dead. Now what that does that mean for you? Now you're unclean. You may have come in contact with somebody who sinned and they're unclean, or who's physically sick and they're unclean. And so you've got to go through ceremonial cleansing all the time. Man, think about the waste of water. We wouldn't be able to handle a drought now, would we? Nevertheless, there was all kinds of things that, and by the way, they did even have a plan for that. They said, okay, well, if you don't have much water, then you just do this portion of the hand, the lower half. Incidentally, if you study this online, you'll find that there are multiple different ways of washing your hands ceremonially. The one that I gave you, the video, had pouring the water how many times? Three times, right? Most of the guys say, oh, no, it's two times. And here's another thing. How was he holding his hands when he poured the water? Well, he's holding them out like that. Okay, but some others say, oh, no, this is you're bad here. You got to turn them like this, okay, with your fingers pointed down, because you got to wash that bad stuff off. And you don't want any of that bad stuff going up here, right? Because it might contaminate you later. So you got to wash it off straight down with water going down off of your fingertips. Then, and here's where the text actually talks about this washing as being a fisting. Did you see him fist at all during the video? Yeah, he actually does this, right? Okay, you know what he did wrong? This is really, really bad, by the way. What?
Do tell.
I will. He, while he was still washing his hand, started the prayer. No. Oh, no. This is obviously not an Orthodox Jew that did this one, okay? Because you're supposed to stop the washing. And by the way, notice now you've got your hands this way, so now the water is going down off, and then you dry your hands, and then you pray. You don't pray while you're doing this washing stuff, because you're unclean then. And you don't interrupt God. You pray. And then, notice now what he did say next. After you're done with the hand washing and the prayer, which is the Shema, the blessing of Israel, right? After you finish that blessing, now what do? Don't talk. Don't talk. Say nothing. Go to table. Take the bread out. And by the way, you had 2.5 big things of matzah, because this is again Passover. So you'd pull the three pieces out. You'd take the one off. You'd do the Shema, the blessing, again. Then you ate that whole thing. Because remember, this used to be just the priest, so it was the priest doing all the eating. So anyways, so even at the table now with Passover, you eat that whole big piece of bread, which you remember is it's basically a large wafer kind of cracker thing. You eat that. After you've blessed it again, I think I said that. You eat that, you bless again, and now you can finally talk. Some of you are ADD or are really having a hard time staying with that, aren't you? And those of you who like to talk, you know, you're extrovert, you're like, this is not going to work, is it? Now, and think about this. You've got to do the ceremonial cleansing and washing of your hands. As you change courses in the meal, as you get bread again, you've got to continue to do the ceremonial cleansing. I'm thinking that fishermen don't do it when they're out on the boat. What do you think? You're out fishing, and it's time to eat, and you're hungry. Now, what do? I think you just eat. Now, you might even, you know, thank you, God. But you're going to just eat. You're not going to go through all this ceremonial. Because what I didn't remind you of was just that you had to have a special pot where the water came out of. See, that's another thing. That's why we know he wasn't Orthodox, because where'd the water come from? Faucet. It's not being kept in a clean container. A container that holds the water, that has a lid on it so that no contamination can get in there by any other unclean person. And now you pour out that clean water and you go ceremonially cleanse yourself. And the Pharisees came to Jesus. And where did they come from, by the way? If you look closely at the text, it says that they came from Jerusalem. Why'd they come out here to the Sea of Galilee, out to the desert, to look, to see Jesus? Because the hostility is already growing against him. And they're already going to point out what he's doing wrong, and that's why they're there. And as they're watching, and they're good watchers, because they see when people are off and messing up and doing something bad, and it's their job to point it out to them. And your disciples don't wash their hands before they're eating. And friends, just so you know, this had nothing to do with whether you washed your hands for hygiene, did it? This is all about a ceremony. Let's talk about that for a minute. In fact, I think I got the next slides up. Are they ready? Jesus says, and he quotes from Isaiah 29. He says, no wonder Isaiah said this about you. You're hypocrites. You worship in vain. You do things as basically simply repetition, without meaning. You say things with your lips, but you don't mean it in your heart. If we're really honest, has that ever happened to you or me? Do you sing the songs we do on Sunday morning from your heart, or sometimes you just kind of sing them because that's what's up there? I stand and lift up my hands. I heard Paul saying something about the fact of, I don't remember quite his wording. What was it?
Musical blackmail.
He said this was musical blackmail. We stand and lift up our hands. What are y'all supposed to do then? You're all supposed to stand then and lift up your hands, right? Did everybody stand? I have no idea, right? But look at it. He says, musical blackmail, because if you don't do that, then what are you? But if you do it just because you're told, isn't that kind of vain repetition too? So if it's not just coming from your heart, then it's just on your lips. We stand and lift up. No, we're not going to lift up our hands. We stand, and I don't feel like standing. So then you start doing those little rhymes like the kids used to do, right? You know, this little item, I'm going to let it, or whatever it was. And you leave off a word. So we, our hands. And you can't say all the words, can you? Because to say the words and to say them without meaning is what? It's lip service. It's not from the heart. Oh my, do we ever do vain worship here on a Sunday? Hold on, Bill. Too close to home. Not supposed to meddle with our lives here. So let me back up. Next slide, please. This is where they believe Christ was crucified. It's called the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It's a really large building that's been built over this location. There's a golden statue, if you will, there, and golden objects and candelabras and all that are in front of that. That table there is more than a table. There's actually a hole underneath that table in the rock, and you can reach down into that hole and feel where the cross was placed in the rock of Calvary. It's the whole Church of the Holy Sepulchre. There's about four different Christian backgrounds, and I don't remember them all, but I recall Greek Orthodox. There's Egyptian Coptic. There's What's that?
Roman Catholic.
The Roman Catholic. But there's one more, and that's the one I can't ever remember. Anyways, there's four different groups that kind of all use the same building at different times. The funny thing was is that you're on the outside of the building, and they show you these windows up there, and there's this ladder outside one of the windows. What's that ladder up there for? Well, you see, we haven't always been united here. And so some groups, in order to get in there, because other groups controlled the doors, had to climb up that ladder to get inside the Holy Sepulchre, because that was their only way in for their gatherings. Just after we were there in March was the Orthodox celebration of Easter. And we saw these people, and they had like these stick kinds of things, and some of the people were going up and lighting them on fire. And what's really crazy is that when they actually have their Easter celebration, there's almost like a mob that's in there, and they light bunches of these like stock things on fire. And it's like, if the building wasn't stone, it'd all come down, because, I mean, they got fire all over the place, and it's like a kind of crazy going on. And they all just have these different kinds of traditions and all. I'm aware of a church that celebrates some of those different kinds of traditions, and it's a really old building, and they had chandeliers with candles in them, and they would hang down, and there was not a building like this, it's more circular, but they'd have like just one long aisle here, and there was a chandelier right in the middle. And as they would come in procession for their special holidays, particularly Easter, they'd get to the center, and they'd have to drop the banners that they were carrying and the various objects that they had that were too high to get them underneath the chandelier with the candles. As time went on, the church turned electric, and they got rid of the candles. And eventually, they got rid of the candelabra in the center of the church. But as they continued their processions at Easter, they would come down the aisle, and halfway down the aisle, they would drop all the banners and raise them back up. Finally, somebody asked the priest, and said, you know, why do we do that? You know, because everything has meaning, right? When you have a more of a liturgical setting, you know, the colors all matter for the seasons and the spiritual holidays and all. And so each of these things have significance. And so they were actually asking the priest, you know, explain the significance of that. You know, is it something about we're bowing to God in the middle of our lives? Is that what this means? You know, what is the significance of that? And the priest said, you know, I really don't know what the significance of that. Did some research, and he found out that there used to be a candelabra sitting up in the center there that had candles, and they had to dip to get underneath that. And that's no longer there. Now they no longer need to dip, but they do it because they've always done it that way. Now, it's easier for us to see it in an organization, in a church that's more liturgical, for us to see their traditions, right? And of course, we all know that with the Reformation, and especially the Anabaptist movement, that Baptists got rid of all the pictures and all those other kinds of symbols and all. And Baptists don't have anything out there that's a tradition, correct?
Correct.
To the more liturgical person, they're like, where is it? I want something to grab a hold of. But the bottom line is, you all have traditions as well. And you have rituals you go through that Jesus would actually look at and say, you're serving me with your lips, not with your heart. This is a picture of the other part of the Holy Sepulchre. And this is the actual Holy Sepulchre. And this is where you see the candles all out there. And right in the center there, you can't really take note of it, but this is a building that's been placed inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, which is like multiple stories high. Inside there is this building that's been placed over what they believe is the empty tomb. And one of those four churches controls that and allows people in there at certain times and all to go in there. No pictures, by the way, so you get your hand slapped, I'll warn you. Yep, that's why I was warning them. Okay. So there's certain, but these are places really of ritual. But they have meaning, don't they? And the only thing that I want you to realize is that the rituals develop out of good reasons. out of things that people are trying to do that will influence their spiritual life. But the problem is when those rituals become the focus instead of God. And that's what Jesus is now starting to hit on. In fact, as he's talking to the Pharisees, he goes on to say, you know, you have made your rituals more important than the very word of God. More important than the word of God. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions. Or go to verse 13. Thus you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down, and you do many things like that. Incidentally, the Midrash is a writing that was compiled about two centuries after Christ. The Midrash, they decided, you know, we've had this oral tradition that's been going on for such a long time, we need to write it down so it's not lost. Israel was under, again, persecution, and it was falling apart, and so there's not that many of us left. We need to track these traditions and write them down. And they wrote them down in the Midrash. Do you know what in the Midrash? There are 30 chapters on how to ceremonial clean pots and pans. 30 chapters on how to ceremonial clean pots and pans. Whoa. You're not going to find that in the Torah. You're not going to find the details there like that. And yet they got 30 chapters just on that alone. There are something like 20 different sections to the Midrash. In fact, they actually went on then and wrote another book called the Gemara, and that's to interpret the Midrash. And then they put that all in a book called the Talmud that collects it all together and does lessons on how to keep track of all these things. Lord, help us. And what is Jesus saying? He says, look here. He says, you've let go of the commands of God. How does Jesus respond to their question? He responds with, the command of God was honor your mother and father, that it may go well with you. That's one of the commandments. They've cursed that commandment with Corban, broken that law, and they're more concerned about, did you dip twice or three times, upside down or fingers up? Did you dry before or not? Did you pray in between? How did you pray? Did you stop and not say anything? Have you gone through the whole ceremony of washing your hands? And Jesus says, you have made the traditions, the teachings of the elders, is more important than the word of God. And the word of God was honor your mother and your father. In fact, he says, let's go on. He says, he takes you to Isaiah, and he says, in fact, not only have you honored the traditions more than the word of God, you've also honored it more than the prophets. The prophets, Isaiah, which actually says you are worshiping in vain. And Jesus says, you know, look here. The word of God and the word of the prophets, which is the word of God, thus says the Lord, is way more important than anything that elders can say that you've got to keep doing, and any traditions you can come up with. This is what's important, only you've gone for the wrapping paper instead of what's inside it. And you're focused and committed to that. And eventually they will kill Jesus because he breaks their traditions. Matthew 23, Jesus said, judgment will come upon those who offer their lip but not their heart, who draw near with their mouth while their heart is far away. There is a danger in coming to worship and doing lip service to God. That's why 1 John talks about if we can't love the people we see, look around the room. If we can't love each other, the people we see, then how can we say we love God? Jesus, in speaking to the woman at the well, said, a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. those who worship in spirit and in truth. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. Amos said it this way, chapter 5, 21, I despise your religious feasts. I cannot stand your assemblies. Even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. Though you bring choice fellowship offerings, I will have no regard for them. Away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps or guitars. Sorry. But let the justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-falling stream. How did God say it with Samuel when picking a king? He said, the Lord does not look at the things man looks at. Man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. How do you know when you are worshiping God? Isaiah was right, Jesus said, when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. William Temple, the Archbishop of Canterbury, 1942 through 44, Second World War, said, worship is the submission of our nature to God. It is the quickening of conscience by his boldness, the nourishment of mind with his truth, the purifying of the imagination by his beauty, the opening of the heart by his love, the surrender of the will to his purpose. And all this is gathered up in adoration to the most selfless emotion of which our nature is capable. And therefore the chief remedy for that self-centeredness which is the original sin and the source of actual sin. So you have your phone still? Don't send me the question. I've got it. The question is, what do you do that is worship with your lips and not your heart? What do you personally do that is worship with your lips and not your heart? Most of you aren't looking at your white piece of paper or at your text. This is a question I want you to try to answer honestly. It's not a question about somebody else. When we sit in worship and we criticize what's taking place, what are we doing? We're worshiping with our lips, not our heart. When we're upset at somebody else who's here this morning, we're worshiping with our lips, not our heart. When we have things that we know is not right between us and God or us and another person, we're worshiping with our lips, not our heart. When we're talking and chattering and sending notes, which only youth do, right? When our mind is busy with something else, when it's time for football and the pastor's going too long, we're worshiping with our hearts. With our lips and not our hearts. When we don't like the song, or the way it was done, or how often it was done, aren't we worshiping with our lips and not our heart? I wonder if some of you would be open enough to say, or in response to my question, and text me. What do you do personally that is worship with your lips and not your heart? I should warn you, there's a nasty word in this text, isn't there? Did you hear it? How many of you like it when somebody says, "You hypocrite"? How many dislike it when somebody says, "You hypocrite"? Only Peter and me. Oh, Becky, do you? Okay? We don't really like it when somebody calls us a hypocrite, do we? And yet, isn't that what Jesus has just said to the disciples? Excuse me, to the Pharisees? He said, "You hypocrites!" And he's quoting from Isaiah, "You hypocrites!" Well, what's a hypocrite? You know, hypocrites didn't start out being really very bad. A hypocrite was an actor. And it was a person, in fact, Hippocrates was a person who actually put on a mask. You remember that only men did acting, right? Well, what did you do for a woman's part? You have Cleopatra, and so you had to play Cleopatra, right? Well, if you got to have a guy that wears a mask to play the woman's part. That was the hypocrite, the person who was putting on a mask to play a part, the person who's pretending to be something. But that has grown to the point that's become really nasty. In fact, this week, I decided I'd see what the online, you know, things say about what is a hypocrite. And I found that a hypocrite is a, a right-wing conservative Christian. People who wear a mask, they're pretenders, they go through the motions, they're concerned with how we look, but not concerned with our heart. Are you a hypocrite? More concerned with where you sit on a Sunday? Where you park your car? More concerned about whether you sing songs and raise hands because you're told to do it rather than on your own? You give because you have to give? Some of our youth aren't here, but I would be saying to them, you attend because mom and dad made you. Maybe you're a husband or a wife forced to attend because your spouse made you. You criticize what's being done in front. You talk with others, but you don't focus on God. Are you a hypocrite? Or maybe you're a right-wing conservative Christian. And I teach other truths of God while my heart is fighting against Him. Act as though you are caring of someone's situation, but secretly you're judging them for being in that situation in the first place. You ever been talking to somebody and you're praying that they stop talking? More worried about technical musicianship than actual communication with God. We don't have any hassles with stuff and technical things. Praying before meals sometimes. Losing concentration. Whoop. Stop it. I don't know. I worship by singing "God's Not Dead." Okay. Often when I sing in church or when I pray in front of others. This is where you're vulnerable to doing it with lip service, gossiping. And in fact, isn't that one not just doing lip service to God, but isn't that doing worship of evil? Just saying, it's dangerous. Singing to the Lord. Not always relying on what God wants me to say. Do you need to wash your hands? Do you need to wash your heart? Because I've been praying that God would work on our hearts. There are people who come to worship. Why? Well, because this is where I can get food on Sunday. It's where I can get goodies. Maybe it's where I can get some money from somebody. Maybe it's where I can get attention. Aren't we all vulnerable to missing God when we come here? Aren't we all vulnerable to being distracted? Because you see, there's this person talking to us all the time, having this running conversation about life, and they don't shut up. And it's you talking to yourself. And doesn't that person get in the way of worship? So we're going to extend worship a little bit today. As we do, I want you to look at your heart. See, God's real whether you believe him or not. God loves you whether you accept it or not. But God will not force you to worship and to spend an eternity with him unless you choose it. Do you need to choose Jesus again today? Or maybe a first time? What's in your heart? Please, for your sake, don't give Jesus lip service. What does the Lord require of us? Not our wealth, but a broken and contrite heart. A heart that really believes and lives for him. That's what he wants. Worship team, would